Hi guys, this is Vaish from Vaish IAS, and we are going to continue the spectrum series. We had done till chapter 9, part 2. So it is the national movement activities from 1919 to 1939, which is the biggest chapter and which has almost all the important facts which UPSC have been repeatedly asking. So let's continue with chapter 9, part 3. So as you see in the cover page here, this is Motilal Nehru on the left and Jinnah on the right. So it is actually the beginning of communal politics. It had already started in a slow rate, but now it becomes serious. So again, each of them will be presenting their own individual demands before the actual constitution is being written. So let's see how the things get proceeded. And the other picture is the salt satyagraha. So that will be also covered in this particular video. So let's begin. How and why India became communal. So we have been seeing slowly different leaders were coming up representing different groups of communities in India, and they had their own demands. Each one had raised their own needs with respect to their religion, and we have seen the CPIM or the RSS, the Muslim League, different communal related parties have been rising up during this time. So we'll see reasons or how India actually became communal. So basically it evolved in three stages or three kinds of phases it went through. So the first one was communal nationalism. That is, initially, even though religious interests are different for different groups, there was a common secularism at national level. So if you see during Swadeshi movement or the time before that, there was a lot of Hindu-Muslim unity. People always see India as a secular place. They did not have problems with each other with respect to religion. So that was the first phase, communal nationalism. Then it moved on to liberal communalism. Like, the religious interests are different, there should be difference in political, economic and social spheres as well. So slowly we saw, like, around the 1907 Muslim League was formed. By 1909, separate electorates was demanded and it was also received by the Morelimento reforms. So slowly, even though everyone was working together, they were carving out small laws or some provisions related to their religions, but still they were together. And the third, which is the most extreme communalism, which is also the problem at present also, not only that there is a difference in interest, it's also incompatible in nature. That is, they understood like now they cannot work together. So constant conflict, and it was better to separate than killing each other. That is what the stage reached by the time we reached independence. So we'll see what happened. There will be a D-Day which comes in the next chapter. Deliverance Day, D-Day, where the great Calcutta killings, where Muslims and Hindus kill each other. And then finally, it will lead to the two nation theory and Pakistan will be formed. So that and all will happen in the next chapter. So these are just phases. We are just explaining you the phases how the communalism evolved in India. Now we'll see the reasons for this evolution. First one is socio-economic reasons. That is, we have seen the bourgeois class, rising middle class. Among them, Hindus and Muslims both were there. But reservations crept in because of the majority-minority conflicts. That is, even now we have this problem, the number game. Someone will say, we are less in number and we have been not getting the reservations, or we are not getting the adequate education or job, and that is how reservation system itself started. So this is a socio-economic reason. Social reasons were clubbed with the economic reasons, and people were beginning to hate each other. So this is first reason. Second reason, the British policy, obviously, of divide and rule. We have been seeing this right from Swadeshi movement, where British were dividing the whole Bengal region into two. So they purposely will do things which will create hatred among Hindus and Muslims. Basically, they wanted to weaken the Indian national movement. So that is how the British policy of divide and rule proceeded. It was actually vested interest of the Britishers, and that is how ANC and Muslim League were always at loggerheads. Third, communalism in history writing. If you see, Indian history is written in such a way that when you study the ancient history or the prehistory, you never hear of Hindu-Muslim thing. It will be all basically more focused on Vedas, or it will be about Hinduism and Hindu gods, because that was how India was at that time. Then after that, medieval era, we'll see the Delhi Sultanate and Muslim king and lot of Irani, Durrani kingdoms coming inside India. So it is majorly focused on Muslims, where Hindus were little bit less mentioned in the textbooks. So that is how things were proceeding. And in the modern Indian history, both were present and both were hating each other because of these kind of ancient differences. Socio-religious reform movements. We saw, like, when the reform movements were happening in chapters 6, there were movements which were too extreme. So if you see, the Wahhabi movement was there, and also there was Deoband movement in the Muslim community, and there were Shuddhi movement, Arya Samaj and all those things in the Hindu community. So these people were wanting to make the country as their majority. So they were a kind of extreme thinkers, or they were not good for the idea of India as a whole. Wrong policies in nationalism. If you remember, nationalist leaders like Bal Gangadhar Tilak was tagged as a Hindu leader because he was organizing Ganpati and Shivaji festivals. Then activities like dip in Ganga during the Swadeshi movement, both before God and goddesses, before conflicts. So everything was being communalized. Aurobindo, who was an extremist leader, he had a vision of Aryanized India. So again, leaning towards Hinduism. Unity movements did not help much. So even though other leaders who were neutral tried to do things to end this communal issues, it could not help much. So things were going in the wrong direction. Sixth one, communal reaction by majority. In opposition to the Muslim League, separate electorates, etc., the Hindus came up with the Hindu Mahasabha, RSS. So we are not going into detail about these religious bodies, but because Muslim League was politically also active at that time against INC, that is why we discussed Muslim League. But about Hindu Mahasabha and RSS, it's not mentioned in Spectrum, and it's also not required with respect to UPSC. So these bodies were also coming up, which was a counter body to the formation of Muslim League. So these were major reasons actually for rise of communalism in India. Now we'll see three important things which is very, very important for UPSC. The Delhi proposals, the Nehru report, Jinnah's 14 points. Okay. So like I told, each leader came up with their own demands in separate reports. So initially it all started with something called as Delhi proposals. You have to pay extra attention because everything which is going to come is all pointers and you can get confused or mixed up. So try to make notes. If you want to pause the slide and make notes. And another confusing part will be the Delhi thing. There are names which are similar. There is Delhi proposals, then there will be Delhi manifesto which you will learn, then there is a Delhi pact which will come up, and in the last chapter you learn Delhi conspiracy. So there are things which are apt for UPSC to pick up and put in match the following question. We will show you MCQs at the end of this video related to the same, but please remember it is confusing and you have to make notes if you are studying for the first time. Okay, so let's see. In 1927, Muslim League session happened at Delhi. So like the INC sessions were happening in December every year, there used to be a Muslim League session also. So in that time, in 1927, the Delhi proposals were actually started. So Delhi proposals related to Muslim League. So basically four proposals were incorporated. We'll see what were the 4 points. First one is joint electorates instead of separate electorates with reservation for Muslims. So this is a very confusing point if UPSC puts a statement, because you will be always thinking Muslim League will tell only about separate electorates, but that is not the case. In Delhi proposals, they started with telling joint electorates with reservations, and they told 1/3 representation of Muslims should be there. Actually, Indian population does not have 1/3 of Muslims at that time, but still reservations they wanted 1/3. Representation in Punjab and Bengal in proportion to their population, because they considered them as majority of Muslims, and formed 3 new Muslim provinces, Sindh, Balochistan and NWFP. So if you see, these are now the provinces in present day Pakistan. So this all started with the Delhi proposals. 1927, parallelly when the INC session was happening at Madras, the INC accepted these proposals in the session. So they actually told okay to all these 4 Delhi proposals, 4 points in Delhi proposals, but obviously Hindu Mahasabha were against most of them. Now in 1928 February, that is almost the same time when Simon Commission was there in India, Indians Congress leaders, they were trying to form a drafting committee. So even before Ambedkar formed the actual Constitution of India, in 1928 a drafting committee with Motilal Nehru as the head was commissioned, and they will write the first set of laws or rights of Indians or the actual demands they need from the British imperial rule. So we'll see, it's very important. Please make a note of the points which Nehru report is saying. First one, dominion status on the line of self-governing India. So it's a dominion status, not Purna Swaraj or complete independence, it is dominion status alone. So the queen will be obviously on top, the crown will be on top, but India will be a dominion region within that, but with self-governance. Then linguistic provinces. Even today now India is divided as per linguistic provinces. So it was actually started out first, it was mentioned in Nehru report. 19 fundamental rights with equal rights to women, form unions, adult suffrage. So it is mentioning about almost everything which is there in present day constitution. So Ambedkar also took points from here while drafting the constitution. Responsible government at center as well as province, same like today. Full protection to cultural and religious interest of Muslims. Even today we have articles 28 onwards where minority cultural and religious rights are given respect. Complete dissociation of state from religion. This is actually a little bit different from how it is today, because now the state will interfere if it is affecting national interest. But in other countries, USA and all, you see it is totally separated, state and religion. Joint electorates with reservation for Muslims only in areas of minority. So they accepted what was there in the Delhi proposal, but only in regions where Muslims are minority. Sindh to be detached from Bombay, that was also a demand actually from Muslim League, but only after we get the dominion status, not now itself we won't partition it, only after we get dominion status. And basically India will have a unitary structure, that means center will be more powerful. Even the residual powers will be with the center. What is residual powers? You know, like now as per schedule 7 we have the subjects of India divided into three classes, the central union one, the state one, and the concurrent list. Other than that, if anything is not mentioned in these three lists, that will be considered residuary subjects, and that power will be with the center. That is how it is there now also. Okay, so this was basically Nehru's report. It is very important, these 9 points. I have made it into very simple sentences so that you understand it. So please make a note of it, it can be a question. The other committee members other than Motilal Nehru were Tez Bahadur Sapru, Subhash Bose, Mangal Singh, Ali Imam. Okay, and those who were unhappy with this Nehru report were obviously Hindu Mahasabha, Muslim League, because both of them did not get what they wanted in full form. They had only partial satisfaction. But what was the problem with Jawaharlal Nehru and Subhash Chandra Bose? Because it was actually because of the time given. Nehru report had actually planned like we'll give this proposal to the government and we'll give them 2 or 3 years time to study it. But Jawaharlal Nehru and Subhash Chandra Bose, who were the young leaders at that time, they were not ready to give that much time. They wanted immediate independence. So they will actually go apart, not move completely out, but they will form a separate body called Independence for India League. So this is also a potential prelims question. Independence for India League was formed by Jawaharlal Nehru and Subhash Chandra Bose. Similarly, in the last video I had asked you a question, or I had showed you a point like Motilal Nehru and C.R. Das, they together formed a body called Swarajya Party. So you should remember facts like this: Motilal Nehru and C.R. Das, Swarajya Party, Jawaharlal Nehru and Subhash Chandra Bose, Independence for India League. Okay. Another body is there, Indian League, which I had taught you in the last chapter. Try to tell me in comments who started Indian League. Now all party conference will happen where everyone will come together at Calcutta and they are reviewing the Nehru report. But Jinnah obviously was not happy, and he'll again ask for 1/3 representation of Muslims at Central Legislative Assembly, reservation to Muslim in Bengal and Punjab as per population till the suffrage is coming, till it is approved, residual powers to the provinces. So this he's actually contesting what is mentioned in Nehru report. So those were the points. Obviously everything was rejected by INC and Hindu Mahasabha. So now that is when Jinnah will come up with his own 14 points. So the leaders are now like, they are not ready to accept something in unanimous form. They always had their own versions and they are coming up with their own reports, that too communal basis. So that is this whole chapter is about this thing only. Nehru came up with a centralized one and Jinnah is putting another point, another report with Muslim demands. So we'll see what are the 14 points. I'm sure you will not be able to remember everything, but I'll show you the points in order so that it will be interconnected. Almost all the points are repeating itself. We'll see the 14 points quickly. Federal constitution with residuary powers to provinces. Provincial autonomy. So he is changing everything towards province because he wanted the Muslim states or regions to be empowered. No constitutional amendment without involving states. So he's again focusing on states. All legislatures and elected bodies to have representation of Muslims. So he's not telling about minority or specific places. He's telling all the bodies should have representation of Muslims. Separation of Sindh from Bombay immediately. So he told he cannot wait for the dominion status. He wants separation immediately. And all the distribution of territories or whatever allocation is doing, it should not affect Punjab, Bengal or NWFP. That is, the Muslim area should have always their power or their majority. That is what they wanted. Reforms in NWFP, Balochistan. So he is focusing on all these states again. If you see all these initial seven points, everything is focusing on states, but it is just rephrased in different ways. Next is again 1/3 representation of Muslims at center. 1/3 representation in any cabinet formed at center or province. No bill to be passed if 3/4 of the minority feels it is against their interest. So if the minority group, 3/4 of them, tell like this bill should not be passed, it shouldn't be passed. So again, Muslims. Adequate representation of Muslims in all service and self-governing bodies. Full religious freedom for all. Protect Muslim rights in religion, culture, education and language. So if you see the 13 points which we saw is everything like give reservation and focus on states where Muslim is in majority, separate regions like Sindh, Punjab, Bengal, NWFP, Balochistan, autonomy to states, everything was states. Now the last one is the most important because it is about separate electorates. So in the initial Delhi proposal it was joint electorates, but after the Nehru report comes up, Jinnah again goes back to the old thing and tells now we need separate electorates. So please remember, when question is asked, this kind of transition was happening. Model Minto reforms is separate electorates, Delhi proposal is joint electorates, now Jinnah's report is again separate electorates. Now before the civil disobedience happens in 1931-32 time, there are many other happenings. So we'll see what was the prelude. 1928 is the time now, and INC session happens in Calcutta. Nehru report was approved. Okay. Seniors like Gandhi and Motilal Nehru wanted to give 2 years time, but youth like Jawaharlal Nehru version wanted to reduce it to 1 year. We have already seen this point. Now if the government won't accept, then demand for Purna Swaraj and CDM. So this is the two things which we'll learn now. Purna Swaraj and CDM if government don't accept this Nehru report. Gandhi meanwhile, what was he doing? He was travelling far and wide, gathering masses and making them ready because he knew another mass movement was needed. Congress Working Committee, they organised the usual boycott committee and they were again spreading this far and wide. In England meanwhile, the Labour Party comes to power. If you remember last chapter, we were discussing the same thing. Conservative Party and Labour Party were there, and Conservative Party was about to finish their tenure and elections were coming up. So now Labour Party comes up under Ramsay MacDonald. He is very important, we'll see why. Lord Irwin becomes the Viceroy and he gave statement regarding dominion status. So obviously the Viceroys always did this. Whenever problems are coming up, they will give some statement which is favouring the INC leaders. So he gave statement about dominion status and told we'll have round table conferences. This was the origin of round table conference after Labour Party comes up in 1928. So they told let the Simon Commission give its report, immediately we'll conduct round table conferences where INC, the Labour Party, the opposition party, that's Conservative Party, all the stakeholders involved, everyone will come together in London and we will discuss on dominion status. That was decided. Now we will see Delhi Manifesto. So we have seen Delhi Conspiracy, we have seen Delhi Proposal, and now it is Delhi Manifesto, which happened in 1929. It is actually related to the Round Table Conference. That is what was actually the manifesto or agenda which INC people wanted out of the Round Table Conference. That is called Delhi Manifesto. Okay, it was given to the British government, and basically they wanted two things. Right away accept demand for dominion status. That is, before even going to the conference, you should accept that you will give us dominion status. And in the round table conference, what you should do is not discuss, just tell the process of implementation. That is what the first condition. Second is Congress should have majority representation at RTC. Okay, Congress should be in majority, because usually they will not be in majority and they will have to participate in votes, voting and all, and then put up their view. But they wanted majority here. Actually, there is one more point. There is 3 points: amnesty and general policy of conciliation. So there should be fair discussion of whatever is happening. So this is the Delhi Manifesto before even going to the first round table conference. But obviously, if you see, these demands were more pro-oriented to the INC, and obviously Lord Irwin rejected all these demands. So Delhi Manifesto was not successful. Now what is happening parallelly? INC session at Lahore the next year. Jawaharlal Nehru was made the president now. Okay, 1929 and 1930, you should remember, it was Jawaharlal Nehru. And in 1931, it will be Sardar Vallabhai Patel, the presidents of INC sessions. I'm telling you few in each slide so that it gets imprinted in your mind. So his statement was, we have an open conspiracy to free this country from foreign rule, and you comrades and all countrymen and countrywomen are invited to join it. So he was actually the youth leader at that time, and he was very much interested to make India independent immediately, not like going and signing treaties or going and discussing too much. They wanted immediate independence. So the major decisions which happened in that session was boycott the RTC. So because the Delhi Manifesto failed, the first round table conference will be boycotted as per Jawaharlal Nehru's decision. Complete independence declared as aim of INC. Launch CDM. So we saw, like, if the Motilal Nehru report or if the Delhi Manifesto failed, they had already planned of launching CDM and told don't pay taxes and asked everybody to resign. December 31, 1929, in the banks of river Ravi, Jawaharlal Nehru hoisted the flag telling the slogan Inkilab Zindabad. So this is also a question, river Ravi. January 26, 1930, the most important date of that time, was fixed as the first Independence Day and Independence Pledge in all villages. So now also, you know, in our preamble, it is written, the date is November 26, 1949. But it was actually enacted or came into force only in January 26, 1950. So that delay from November to next January was just to coincide with this date, because this day, January 26, was considered as the first Independence Day. So that is why Republic Day is being celebrated on January 26, 1950 now, just to make it coincide. Or else they could have made November 26 itself, 1949. Just to coincide, they waited 2 months and then only they enforced it. So you should know this story, this reason. And what did they pledge? We have every right to be free. British has ruined us politically, economically, culturally, spiritually. We hold it a crime to man and God to submit any longer to British rule. That is, being like slaves under them were actually a crime now. No real political power given to us, and our administration skills are being killed. The education system has torn us apart from our traditions and culture. We will work towards Purna Swaraj. Withdraw from all voluntary association with British and prepare for CDM. So this was like this 1929 session at Lahore is one of the most important sessions of all the sessions, because India has decided that now we are independent and we are free and we will launch CDM and we will not follow any British laws and engage with any discussions with them. So it's very important. So make a note of all the things mentioned in this slide. Now next is Gandhi's 11th point, which will come up, because Gandhi always gave a second chance before launching any mass movement. So before even going to launch a civil disobedience movement, he thought he'll give 11 points which he wanted them to accept, so that it's the last chance given to the British. So the date also was given, January 31, 1930. If you see, that is just 5 days after Nehru declaring independence. So we'll see that in three different headings: legislative steps, then few for the bourgeois class, and 2 points will be for the peasant class. So he had demands for almost every section of the society. So first were legislative steps, like reducing expenditure by 50%, introduce total prohibition, that is the dry state thing, carry out reforms in criminal investigation department, change arms act allowing popular control of issue of firearm licenses, release all political prisoners, accept postal reservation bill. So these were all legislative things where some bill or something has to be passed or repealed. So if you see, 6 points are related to legislative steps, and Gandhi put forward this. For the bourgeois class, or something related to economy, will be reduce the rupee sterling exchange ratio. So the currency exchange ratio had to be reduced. Introduce textile protection, like, you know, they were crumbling the entire Indian handloom society, handloom community. So introduce protection for them. Reserve coastal shipping for Indians. So the coastal shipping should be reserved only for Indians, and Britishers should not involve in it. Now this is for peasant. Reduce land revenue by 50%. Abolish salt tax and government's salt monopoly. So Britishers were like, Indians should not produce salt, and they should only buy what is produced by the Britishers. So that much, and they were also taxing each and everything unwantedly. So Gandhi put that also as the 11th point. So Gandhi's 11 demands, please make a note, this can be a question. If you see, remember last time in ethics paper, they are asked Gandhi's 7 sins. That is altogether a different thing, but when it comes to Gandhi, you cannot take a chance. You have to make a note of it, because question can directly come, Gandhiji's 11 demands, or compare it with Jinnah's 14 points or Nehru's report. Those three important reports or demands we have learnt, please make a note of everything. When you read it again and again, obviously it will be there imprinted in your mind. February 1930, till now no response from government. So the date has crossed whatever it was given. IMC allocated full freedom to Gandhiji now to initiate the civil disobedience movement. Gandhiji chose salt. So why did he choose salt itself? Because civil disobedience movement can be done anyway by breaking any law, but he chose salt. We'll see what was the reason. The most inhuman poll tax ever. So basic thing like salt was being taxed, and he considered it as the most inhuman thing. He understood, like, it can easily gather all the masses together because it is related to everyone. And another most important thing is, even the urban class would connect. That is, salt is something like every household needs. It's not like only the rural people need. There's rural and the urban, so together will come and fight for it. So Gandhi's strategical move of this choosing salt is one considered one of the biggest achievements for Indian national movement. So we will see the salt satyagraha in detail in the next slides. Dandi March, the salt satyagraha, which we have been learning right from the time we have started learning Indian history. In every class, every chapter, this thing will be mentioned and everybody will know about it. So we'll see details about it. March 12, 1930. So see, the timeline is going faster. It is not like we are waiting months or years. Now we are doing it immediately. 8 members started from Sabarmati Ashram at Ahmedabad to Dandi, which is a coastal village. So thousands gathered at the ashram before the march began. Gandhiji gave instructions like he will tell, like, even if he is arrested, the others should listen to other leaders. It's not like only if Gandhi is there it should proceed. They should also listen to other local leaders. Wherever possible, salt satyagraha should be carried out. Foreign liquor, clothes shops should be picketed. Lawyers, government servants should give up their jobs. So these are almost again terms similar to what happened in non-cooperation movement and Swadeshi movement. But every time it will be little bit different. This time the main leader is Mahatma Gandhi. And it is for national movement. If you remember, non-cooperation was not for national movement. Swadeshi also was not for national movement. It was for other events. But this is a national movement. Refuse to pay taxes if can. All these should be done on two ideas. So he is telling, do everything, but focus on truth and non-violence. He did not want any incident like Chauri Chaura, which happened in non-cooperation movement. April 6, 1930. Reached Dandi and picked up handful of salt. This is the picture, the live actual photograph of that. Tamil Nadu, so we'll see different leaders actually, because this also has been asked in prelims. Different leaders are, C. Rajagopalachari was in Tamil Nadu. So this was the place, like, from and to, like, Mahatma Gandhi went from Ahmedabad to Dandi. This is Tiruchirappalli to Vedaranyam. K. Kerala, Kegalapan, Calicut to Payyanur. Assam, Satyagrahis walked from Sylhet to Naukhali. So, if you see, it is going through the East Bengal also. So, Muslim leaders were also involved. You should remember that. In Andhra, camps were set up. So, the name is Sibirams. So, make note of that name also. Sibirams, which place is it related to? Andhra Pradesh. It was the headquarters of Salt Satyagraha. Now, Nehru gets arrested. Gandhi gets arrested. So, obviously, protests will be there everywhere. Congress Working Committee sanctioned the following. Non-payment of revenue in Rayatwari areas. No Chowkidari tax. So, they are like restraining from paying any tax or any revenue to the Zamindars or Britishers, and violation of forest law in central provinces. So this became a huge mass movement geographical wise and also the action wise. They are doing or affecting all sections of classes and economy. So this is the whole thing about Dandi March. What is the impact of Salt Satyagraha and agitations across India? So we'll see the participation and we'll see what all happened actually. Because in the first slide what we saw is what were the plans. Now we'll see what actually happened. So imports of foreign cloth and other items fell. Government income from liquor, excise and land revenue fell. Elections to legislative assembly were largely boycotted. Extent of mass part, we'll see who all participated. Women, the highest participation ever among all movements till then. It marked their entry into public sphere in huge numbers. You can see the picture. Women participated in the biggest number till date. Sarojini Naidu was one prominent leader. Students played a great role in boycotting. Muslims, very less compared to NCM. So you should know this comparison also. It was very less compared to NCM. And Muslim leaders asked them to stay away, but still there was participation from middle class NWFP Dhaka leaders. So Dhaka, as I told, East Bengal was also involved. So it was less compared, but it was there. Merchants and traders, active participation in Punjab and Tamil Nadu. Workers from Bombay, Calcutta, Madras, so almost everywhere. Peasants active in UP, Bihar and Gujarat. Tribals, central provinces, Maharashtra, Kannada. So all classes in all regions across India was participating in it. Okay, so that is the end of this particular video. We are not going in detail about the rest of the civil disobedience movement or the roundtable conference because it will need little more detailed explanation. So we are going to take it in the last part of chapter 9. So we'll see some MCQs. Arrange the following in sequence from oldest to newest based on its occurrences. So we have seen all these things. You have to arrange it in order. UPSC has asked this question, so you have to be careful. Now this is what I told. Delhi Conspiracy, Delhi Proposals, Delhi Pact, Delhi Manifesto. We have covered all these things in our lectures. So you can easily answer it if you had focused on it. Only Delhi Pact, the third one, I have not taught you till now. And another problem is Delhi Pact, actually 3-4 pacts are referred to as Delhi Pact in different Wikipedia pages and different textbooks. So it can be a little bit confusing. So I'll tell you 3 is actually right in this case. Jawaharlal Nehru and Liaquat Khan. It is one of the Delhi Pact. There was another Delhi Pact also, which we'll see in the next next video only, I think. There is a Delhi Pact which happens, which was between the Gandhi and Irwin actually. Gandhi-Irwin Pact is sometimes referred as Delhi Pact. That we'll see in the next video. But here in this question, statement 3 is correct. The other 3 I have taught you, so try to answer in comment section whether all the 4 statements are correct or not. One more question, which are the following are true regarding Nehru Report? This is also a little bit confusing because what I taught you and what this question has a little bit of extra points. First one is it defined fundamental rights and citizenship. Second, it demanded complete independence for India. There will be no separate electorates. India will have a federal structure with bicameralism at center. I want you people to attempt this. Whoever attempts this in the comment section, I will give you the right answer. Because I want you people to put effort. It's not like every time you simply listen to lectures and then forget about it. You have to start putting effort. It's already about mid of December now and time is running out. So it's not really history that we have to learn. We have to learn a lot of subjects. So try to be strong in history fundamentals, modern Indian history. So if you want to buy the entire PDF with over 320 questions based on the spectrum, from where we are putting questions at the end of each slide. If you want to buy the whole set, contact this Facebook page, facebook.com/vaishayas, and please subscribe to this channel and give some comments and feedback, because only then I will know like what is actually happening or running in your minds. Okay, so let's wait till chapter 9's part 4 is uploaded. Till then, thank you. Have a nice day.